Good morning, everybody. Today I'll talk about neorealist perspective, from a neorealist perspective, about Turkish foreign policy towards the Balkans. I'm from Turkey, by the way. We have a short time, so let me start by evaluating our research question. Our research question, by the way, should I use this one or everybody here? Our research question asks whether neorealism approves Turkish foreign policy towards Balkans, of course with respect to the changing nature of international political system, or if it doesn't, if it disapproves Turkey's foreign policy, if it criticizes, like most of the neorealists criticize, the American invasion of Iraq or intervention in Iraq. Well, let me start by asking this question. Is there a new, brand new world order? The answer is no, because there is still the United States is the superpower. No other superpower replaced the United States. But there is a change in international political system. Let me go back to history to see this change. In 1989, the wall collapsed after the Iron Curtain fell. So the world turned into unipolarity from bipolar world. And the United States emerged as the only superpower, which requires normally from a neorealist or from all kinds of realist assumptions. This requires balancing. Let me remind what balancing is. Simply put, balancing is the reaction of other states to a growing power. What type of balancing is possible? Normally, there are two types of balancing. One of them is internal balancing, the other is external balancing. If you have, as an international actor, if you have sufficient capabilities, then you mobilize your resources and balance internally by your resources. If you don't have sufficient capabilities against an aggressive power or increasing power, then you need to search for alternatives. What this alternative is forming alliances with other regional or global powers. But after 1990, the unipolarity persists, and any international actor, no one did question this unipolarity. They did not try to balance the United States. So there are reasons underlying this lack of balancing. First of all, first argument says that the U.S. power provides certain benefits to international order, to other actors. For example, for the European powers, United States provides a balance among them. Germany, for instance, does not need to be afraid of French power, and vice versa. The same thing is relevant for the Far East. Japan could spend much of its efforts to economic development instead of militarizing against any kind of Chinese threat. And also, the U.S. power provides an umbrella against Russian threat, Russian resurgence, for example. Another argument says that the United States does not pose a threat as a hegemon. The United States is a dominant power, but it's not a hegemonic power. This means that the United States does not impose its wills on others. A neorealist, Stephen Wolf, explains this by the new concept, balance of threat concept. This is different from balance of power, classic understanding of balance of power. This requires that the states are balancing if the power, if the growing power is a threatening power. Last but not least, the United States is not balanced by others because it's extremely powerful. If you look at the figures, the naval capability of the United States is greater than the aggregate of all other powers, all other major powers, I mean. And also research and development expenses in military terms equals to 80% of Chinese total defense budget. This is enormous stretch. And also another advantage of the United States, in both sides, it is secure because there are big waters, Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. These are the things that stop others balancing. But after 2001, after September 11th, something has changed. I can say United States invaded Iraq, you can say it's an intervention, a peacekeeping operation, anything. But the United States war against terrorism gained a momentum, and this made others anxious about the real intention of United States. Is it trying to form a hegemony or not? Russia and China have been questioning this since the early 1990s, but this time, after 2003, Germany and France also joined them. But if you question unipolarity, you should recommend another structure for the international system. This can be a bipolar world or multipolar world. If it is bipolar, it's not a problem. United States will be probably one actor, and with its growing economic development, China will be another. But if it's a multipolar world, there are many alternatives, but who knows who will be a major power in such a multipolar world. It's hazy, it is not clear for today. This is all about the international system. Now, let's shift to Turkey's position in this international system. Turkey is a rapidly growing economy. Turkey has a dynamic social force with its young population. Geographical location of the country is very important. It's very centrally located. And what about Balkans? Balkans is important for trade. It's important for strategic location. It's important for cultural factors, for international actors. That realism and all realist approach gives special importance to great powers. Let's check great powers. Now, Russia has interests in Balkans. It has close ties, first of all. Secondly, it needs to control the trade routes, particularly energy routes, and security of its western borders is dependent on Balkans, because the Balkans and Turkish Straits are important for security of the Black Sea, and in turn, the security of the Black Sea is important for Russian western borders. What about the United States? Yes, it is it's an important region, but not as important as Russia, because the United States has no borders in the region. No direct threat from the region, no ethnic, religious, or any kind of ties with the region, so it's not vitally important. But it helps the United States to maintain its dominance in Western Hemisphere, and also it helps to control Russian influence in the region. And about Europe. For Europe, different countries have different relations, different ties with regional actors, as you can see, and geographical location provides an important basis for interest into the region. Among the European powers, Germany is more important in neorealist terms, I can say, because if you look at the Germany's activity in the Balkans, you can understand better. Germany recognized earlier than other European Union members in early 1990s, Croatia and Slovenia. Most of you remember this. Is it only the reason that it has close ties with those two countries? I don't think so. It also helps Germany to prevent any other major actors to be influential in the region. Germany wanted to be more influential than any actors because the region is important, as I explained in previous slides. And also, if you look at the Germany's role in peacekeeping missions, you can see that Germany contributes a lot, much more than other major powers. Is this only for the sake of peace in the Balkans and stability for Europe? I don't think so. It is the only reason. Germany prevents any other major actors to deploy forces in the Balkans by deploying its military staff there. And what about Turkey and the Balkans? Let's come to the core argument. Turkey has links with Muslim populations, which goes back to the Ottoman period. The Balkans is a gateway to Europe, particularly for trade, when trade matters is considered. Let me remind you that Turkey has the largest truck fleet in Europe, so they need to pass this region to go to Europe. It's also a bridge between energy supply and demand. European consumers, energy consumers and producers, both located in the south and east of Turkey. Also, security is an important element for Turkey. It's very close to Balkans. From a historical perspective, if you look at the Balkan historical policies, foreign policy towards Balkans, Turkish foreign policy, we first see the Balkan Pact, dated 1934. It's against any threat, particularly from Italy or Germany. If you look at the logic of this pact, it is coherent with neorealism, because it's against the dominance of one or two, great powers in the region. So it is logical from neorealist analysis. Another pact of Ankara, or the Second Balkan Pact, dated 1953, this time the reason is same, but the threat is different from Soviet Russia. So all these are acceptable in neorealist terms. If you look at the Cold War, we can say that Turkey follows a passive foreign policy when compared to previous pacts, because this is due to Turkey's location in the Cold War. Turkey is a part of the Western Bloc, which means that Turkey, in realist terms, was bandwagon. This means that Turkey followed the United States in terms of security, in terms of other policies. So Turkey was passive in the Balkans, and it's also relevant from neorealist analysis. In the post-Cold War period, Turkey's orientation towards the West has not changed. Turkey is still a NATO member. Turkey is still tries to be a EU member more than 6 years, unfortunately. But Turkey follows a more active foreign policy. If you look at the early 1990s, Turkey is one of the countries that recognized the former Soviet republics in Central Asia, in the Balkans as well, Turkey spent a lot of money both in this Central Asia and Balkans for economic cooperation activities. So Turkey is active in the post-Cold War period. And in the post-September 11 period, Turkey engaged trilateral consultation mechanisms with Croatia, Bosnia, and Serbia, also take part in Southeast Asian cooperation process. Turkey sent missions, sent troops to missions, international peacekeeping missions. So Turkey is increasingly active in the region. But why does Turkey follow such a policy? From neo-realist analysis, it's understandable. Turkey does not prefer a great power, any great power, to dominate its surrounding regions. Turkey tries to become a regional power for this purpose, not for hegemonic purposes or any kind of dominance in the region. So, Turkey tries to keep the influence of others at the minimum level. But there is another factor about the current Turkish foreign policy. Professor Ahmet Davutoğlu is the Foreign Minister of Turkey, holds a new policy, a zero problem with neighbors, which aims to become more influential in the neighborhood of Turkey. This policy is due to his belief that active policy in neighboring regions, in regional affairs, is a multiplier of global capabilities of Turkey. This is an important wording by Mr. Davutoğlu. Therefore, Balkans are important for part of regional activity, Turkey's regional activity. There is a motto by Kemal Atatürk, the founder of, as you all know, Turkey. There is no line of defense but the territory of defense, and that territory is the whole of the motherland. Mr. Davutoğlu changed it into, there is no line of diplomacy but the territory of diplomacy, and that territory is the whole world. Actually, this kind of speech makes our neighbors anxious. I really understand this. Therefore, to conclude, from a neorealist perspective, if Turkey follows a moderate foreign policy that first prevents extreme great power activities in the Balkans, secondly respects other great powers, the interests of other great powers in the Balkans, and if necessary, resort the U.S. as a balancing factor, this policy, this foreign policy approach can be acceptable, plausible from a neorealist point of view. But if Turkey searches for a Lebanese realm in the former Ottoman territories and triggers German, Russia or any other regional actors to engage balancing against Turkey, then this aggressive policy is not acceptable from a neorealist point of view. That's all. Thank you for your patience.